to you by Penguin.
Killer in the Kremlin, written and read by me, John Sweeney. To Lisa Kozlenko, Vlad Demchenko, and Semin Gluzman. Chapter 1. The Killing Machine. Some idiot is moving heavy furniture around in the flat above, and I wake up with a start. I'm about to give Lambeth Council a ring to get them to sort him out, when I remember I'm in Kyiv, and it's 4 o'clock in the morning, and it's not tables and chairs that are going bang, but Russian artillery. The idiot is Vladimir Putin, and his idiot war is 2 days old. I grunt, fall asleep again, get up and go out, try to buy some loo roll, fail. In front of me in the shop is an old geezer and a housewife. The old guy buys 10 packets of the same cigarettes and nothing else, his unique vice on vulgar display to the world. The housewife snaps up every saveloy in the shop, anxiety buying on a comic scale. It's funny, but it's not amusing. The walk from my Airbnb near the Olympic Stadium to the centre of town takes half an hour. Khreshchatyk, the great street of the Ukrainian capital, has the flavour of a neo-Stalinist take on Bath's great Georgian crescent, with extra vodka shots. It's so wide you could drive 3 tanks abreast down it. This is Putin's plan. Halfway along, I start chuntering into my phone camera when a tough-looking dude with a very pucker British accent points out that I'm walking past the town hall and that is not a good place to be today. I explain to my fellow Brit that the Russians are not going to hit the town hall today, that's for later, and move on smartly. By the time I get to the post office building, a great curl of sound walls up in front of me, like a monster wave at sea. It's the air raid siren going off big time, warning of incoming Russian artillery or missile fire. The noise is obscene. They call it Putin's lullaby. I record a little piece to camera into my phone and tweet it as the sirens wail. I'm worried about Roman Abramovich's yacht. I do hope it's okay. Someone on Twitter replies, sink the yacht. Up through Maidan Square to the rented flat of my pal, Oz Kataji, a British-Lebanese reporter who is half my age. Oz offers me a cuppa of Earl Grey. We sip our tea like the English milords we might be in some parallel universe, and through the window we hear a big crump of artillery. It's not close, but this is never a good sound. Crump. Vladimir Putin takes me back to revising for A-level English in 1976 and Wilfred Owen's great poem, Anthem for Doomed Youth. Only the monstrous anger of the guns. Both Oz and I are freelance, hoping to scratch a living by doing two-way interviews with radio stations like BBC Northern Ireland, Scotland, LBC and RTE in Dublin. Each hit doesn't earn much, but after a run you can buy a kebab or two. We faff about for a bit, trying and failing to get a cab or someone to drive us towards the war. Nothing doing. Anyone with a vehicle is driving their loved ones to the train station to get them out. We take the metro. You see anxiety scribbled on people's faces. A mum slapping her kid, doing no wrong. An old lady mystified while her daughter barks into her phone. Tough men in combat uniform surging in and out of the tube carriages as if there is a war on, which, of course, there is. We get out of the Arsenal stop, the deepest underground station in the world. It's built into the side of the cliff that makes Kyiv a natural citadel, one where the Rus civilization was founded 1,000 years ago. Moscow was, is, and always will be the branch office. Out of the carriage, we're hit by a tide of human misery. It feels like walking along a tube platform during the London Blitz in 1940. Hiding from Russian bombs in February 2022 are an old couple, fast asleep, an old woman surrounded by shopping bags full of stuff, the muscles on her face twitching uncontrollably. Two sweet kids, transfixed by a film on their phone, a silly dog at their feet. Damn you, Vladimir Putin. We ride the escalator out, walk to the west bank of the River Dnipro, edging north. The Russian army is rumoured to be up ahead. I have to stop to talk to Jeremy Vine for his BBC Radio 2 show. He's Middle England, but a vital conveyor to ordinary people. And Oz moves on. That's the last I see of him this day. As I walk along, I film myself and, in the distance, capture a couple of Ukrainian soldiers hovering near the triumphal arch to the friendship between the Russian and Ukrainian peoples. No irony here, folks. A soldier shouts at me to stop filming. I put my camera down, walk on another 100 yards, and start filming some more. Fool, Sweeney, fool. A young Ukrainian with a rifle starts shouting at me. He's not dressed in full camo, but sports plain green trousers. Other guys wave guns in my general direction. Mr. Greentrews wants my phone to see the videos I've taken. Do I look like a Russian spy? I'm wearing an orange beanie, a camel-coloured duffel coat as first worn by Trevor Howard, playing Major Calloway in The Third Man, and a brown corduroy jacket with elbow patches. I look like an unemployed geography teacher from Dorking. He demands my phone. It's bonkers. Do I look like a Russian spy? I'm yelling at him, and I can holler. If you doubt that, ask a member of the Church of Scientology. The guns are no longer waving in my general direction. They are pointing at me. I hand over my phone, passport, and NUJ press card, and, with my hands in the air, they walk me to their base. A steel door closes behind me. No one has seen me enter it. No one has seen my arrest. I'm in trouble. We're in a pumping station that keeps half of Kyiv supplied with fresh water. It smells of old ironmongery, properly oiled. Someone makes a phone call to Ukrainian intelligence, the SBU, the Sluzhba Bezpeki Ukrainia. I keep on saying, look at my Twitter banner. Greentrews whistles up his commander and his second in command, who are the real thing, fully attired in Ukrainian army uniform. The boss is a big man, bigger than me, and I'm no petty four. The deputy is smaller, but sharp. He eyes me up with amused irony. I suspect that he knows I'm no threat. The two men remind me of Captain Mannering and Sergeant Wilson from Dad's army. But the boss scowls at me and says, Ruski shpion. I did Russian at school, and have forgotten nigh on all of it, but I can work out Russian spy. At this, I sit down and start laughing uncontrollably. The Russian spy does not seem suitably afraid. The mood changes. Greentrews googles me and, about bloody time, sees the photo on my Twitter banner of me challenging Putin to his face. In July 2014, a Russian Buk missile fired from pro-Kremlin eastern Ukraine killed everybody on board Malaysia Airlines flight MH17. I got to doorstep the president of Russia in Siberia and ask him about the killings in Ukraine. Greentrews finds the photo in which Donald Trump is standing over me, seeking to shake my hand to signal the end of our 2013 interview, but I remain seated with palm upheld. My question was, Mr. Trump, why did you buy your concrete from Fat Tony Salerno? Of the two of us in the photo, one may be a Russian spy, but it's not me. An old granny appears with a cup of tea for the prisoner. Greentrews then becomes my champion. He introduces himself as Vlad Demchenko, a sweet and bright filmmaker, who tells me he made a documentary about the battle for Donetsk Airport in 2014. In a previous existence, before the war, he went travelling, like you do. His English is pretty good, and we're getting on well, but the call has been made to the SBU So I'm locked inside military bureaucracy, trying to prove my innocence of the worst charge possible. It's like fighting a charge of treason in a foreign language with people armed with guns. We get into a big brown pickup truck, the commander at the wheel, his 2IC riding shotgun, and Vlad and I are in the back. Checkpoints are going up across.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.